There's several physiological processes that inevitably lead to cellular aging. But if telomeres can be extended and DNA can be repaired, lifespan is like any other trait. And so we can ask, what determines the level of DNA repair, and hence ultimately lifespan? In the simplest way, we know that small things can grow up very quickly, and that makes sense because you're just a single cell, you're done. But if you're a very big organism, it takes a long time to grow up. And so we have an inevitable relationship between body size along here and lifespan. Large things live a lot longer than short things. Now, as an example of this, let's look at whales. Whales are amongst the biggest animals ever to live. And a 100-ton bowhead whale is known to have lived to be 211 years in the wild. They've been subject to frequent whaling over the centuries. Here's a picture from New England back in the 1700s. And it's still being taken place today that there are Native Americans who go after these animals. Well, recently, a bowhead whale was harpooned again, and in the carcass they discovered the harpoon tip of an animal that was actually speared in 1890, and it lived for another 118 years afterwards. This is just an indication of how long some of these animals can live. But even though there's this overall relationship between size and lifespan and generation time, we know that some species may live a lot longer than others, even though they're the same size. So let's contrast frogs with mice. Frogs and mice are about the same size, yet frogs live almost 10 times as long. Since some species of a given size can live far longer than others, we want to ask about what evolutionary factors influence how long we live. One of the best ways to put this into perspective is to keep in mind that outside of our own cells, there are many forces that can kill us. And so we're going to talk about extrinsic mortality. So this is death by external causes. And with this kind of external mortality, very few individuals are going to live to old age anyway. So these extrinsic causes can be things like predation, a spider eating a butterfly or a moth, a bird eating a spider. We can starve to death. We can have a terrible disease. We can be struck by lightning. Even trees die when they're struck by lightning. We can fall on the ice. When we have a lot of extrinsic mortality, no matter how many individuals are born, a lot of them are going to die before they would otherwise reach old age. So we have extrinsic mortality. Let's imagine we have a lot of young individuals, children. They're all 10 years of age, okay? And sometime between childhood and early adulthood, a fair number are killed one way or the other. They get run over by a truck, or they otherwise behave foolishly, okay? 20-year-olds get killed too, so they're not that many are still alive by 30. Fewer survive to 40, even fewer to 50, and very, very few make it to 60 years of age. So these are the result of extrinsic mortality that's sort of at random removing individuals from a population. Now, if different species have different rates of extrinsic mortality, this will shape their life histories. We want to be able to take this pattern of extrinsic mortality then to understand our kind of inborn, programmed rate of physiological aging or senescence. So this is the evolutionary outcome of a particular pattern of extrinsic mortality that's typical in that species. Now, remember that fitness is the product of both survival and reproduction. And to maximize genetic representation in the next generation, individuals need to survive to reproduce, but it can be advantageous once we've reached breeding age to sacrifice our survival in order to reproduce more efficiently. So let's look at two contrasting life history strategies. First, we'll call iteroparity, repeated breeding. If I reiterate something, I repeat it, okay? So itero. Then we can have similparity, the opposite. That's an explosive, one-time, suicidal breeding effort, okay? And to be able to remember similparity, it might be useful to recall from Greek mythology, simile. who fell madly in love with Zeus, and she insisted, "Zeus, Zeus, let me see your full power." Well, he relented finally, and when he did, she caught on fire. End of simile. She had her one explosive moment with Zeus. Okay, so let's look at African elephants. Elephants are big. They live for over 70 years. They're not mature sexually until they're 15 years. And they only have one baby every 5 years. So this is classic iteroparity, one child after another, year after year after year. Now let's look at the Pacific salmon. After having spent 5 years in the oceans, they then start migrating towards the mouths of rivers and then swim upstream for several weeks. On the way up, the males' mouths become transformed into weapons so they can fight with other males. Once they get up to the breeding grounds, they spawn like crazy, and then they drop dead. Every salmon just makes one trip, that incredible journey up into the mountains, spawns, and then is dead. So that's a classic case of similparity or Big Bang reproduction, all at once, and they're done. Now we see this kind of contrast in all kinds of different organisms. So in plants, there's this unpronounceable plant up here, Alstroemeria or something, which is a perennial, may set seeds year after year after year. And then there are grasses like canary grass, which are again perennial. They have their seeds year after year after year. But then a close relative of the flowering plant is the zinnia, and that's an annual. It has its seeds once and then it dies. Crabgrass has its seeds once and then it dies. So iteroparity on the left, similparity on the right. In extremes, we have trees like the bristlecone pine in Wheeler Peak, Nevada, that's estimated to be about 4,850 years old. And there's a Norway spruce in Sweden that's known in amongst the Swedes as Old Jiko, who's 9,500 years old. Incredibly long-lived trees. And yet, here in the Midwest, we have trees called redbuds, and they only live to be about 20 or 30 years of age. So again, that huge contrast in lifespan. So how could we have iteroparity, repeated breeding, or explosive breeding, or similparity? Well, let's do a thought experiment. And let's take the extreme form of iteroparity, where the individual is actually immortal. It lives forever, and it has babies at regular intervals. So here we have a fish, an immortal iteroparous, or a repeated breeding fish, and she has two daughters each season, okay? So there are her two daughters. Then she survives and joins her daughters to breed the following season. They each have two offspring, and they join their daughters the next season. So now we have nine altogether in the population. Now in contrast, we have a similparous female who kills herself in order to produce just one extra offspring, okay? The extra effort in putting her resources into that one extra baby is so much it kills her, okay? So she has the three offspring, and then she's dead. Then they have their three offspring, and then they're dead. But look, they have exactly the same number of representatives in the third generation as our immortal iteroparous female, okay? So the point of this is it doesn't take much extra reproduction to pay for suicidally trying to reproduce. So suicidal reproduction is favored whenever, in this case, these are asexual. An asexual female thereby produces just one additional offspring. If they have more than one extra, then the trait would really be expected to spread. Okay, let's look at the salmon. The salmon on the West Coast have this extraordinary journey out of the Pacific Ocean and up in Northern California, Oregon, Washington, up through British Columbia. They swim up these incredible rivers, going all the way up to the high mountains, okay? And this is an extraordinarily difficult journey. An adult Pacific salmon is unlikely to survive a second round trip. So once they get up there, what's the point in trying to hold back any of your resources? You might as well invest everything in the current reproduction, okay? Because you would then be eaten almost certainly on your way back down or the next trip back up. The best thing you can do as a salmon once you're up there is to put all of your resources into your babies and let them journey back down into the ocean and go back up. So the best thing in this case is to get your genes into this safely into the next generation. Now let's look at Atlantic salmon. Atlantic salmon live in much flatter terrain. They come into New England, and there's some nice hills there, but it's nothing like the huge mountains of the Pacific Northwest. And so what we're going to look at are some fish here that swim in from the Atlantic and go up some of these streams, okay? And what we see is that some of the Atlantic salmon make a fairly long migration, but some make a very short migration. They just go in a little ways and lay their eggs. Now those that make this more difficult journey further inland put more into reproduction. Once they get there, they lay more eggs. Those that are close to the sea, when they go ahead and lay their eggs, they only drop in a few and then they go back into the ocean, okay? So the farther it is, the more likely that you would die yourself from extrinsic mortality, being eaten by bears, or in modern terms, by fishermen. And so you should go ahead and get your genes in the next generation. Get those genes safely into the next generation. But if you don't have very far to go, you are much more likely to survive the trip back into the ocean than your babies are. They're small, they could be eaten by larger fish, whereas if you're an Atlantic salmon, you're a pretty big fish in that pond. So you should look after yourself relatively more and invest less in reproduction when the risks to yourself as an adult are relatively low. So if we go back and look at the elephants are essentially immune to predation. That is, they don't have much risk of extrinsic mortality. Genes are safely residing in their bodies, okay? This lion is wondering, why am I here? This is crazy, I could get crushed, okay? Because the elephants are so well protected against even the largest predators. However, baby elephants are not. Baby elephants can be eaten by lions, hyenas, and so in this case, the elephant should invest more in their survival. That is, more in DNA repair, keeping their telomeres a longer length, because the genetic material is safely residing in the adult bodies more relatively than it would be in the calves. So, age-specific patterns of mortality determine whether to invest more in adult survival or in reproduction. If mortality is highest in the infants, the adults should invest more in looking after themselves than they should in reproducing. Their genes are perfectly safe in their own bodies, comparatively speaking. But if mortality is much higher than the adults, so you're a Pacific salmon who's exhausted by that long trip up the river, then you should get your genes safely into the next generation rather than try to look after your own physiological health. Now, a very nice study of this principle has been performed in Trinidad in the Caribbean by a scientist named David Resnick. And his study animal was the guppy, a small, boring little fish that lives in these streams in Trinidad. Now, this is a very simplified map of the island of Trinidad, and you have a series of streams running from the ridgetops down into the ocean. And each stream in his study had a different community of predators. Guppies lived in both streams, but in this light blue stream, the only predator that was there specialized in eating baby guppies, whereas in this dark blue stream, the only predator there specialized in eating adult guppies rather than the babies. So if we look at the effect that this different pattern of mortality has had on reproductive patterns, we see that where there's been predation solely on the young guppies, the guppies have fewer eggs per brood. They wait longer between broods before they breed again, and then they start breeding themselves at an older age. So they invest less in reproduction when the babies are higher at risk of predation. But in situations where the predators focus on the adults rather than the young, there's much more emphasis on reproduction. So there's more eggs per brood, there's shorter intervals between broods, and they start breeding at a younger age. They're in a hurry to get those genes into the next generation. So the important part of this study is an experimental component. There was a third stream that lacked guppies altogether. There was the predator on the young guppies, but there were no guppies yet for them to eat. So Resnick took guppies from the stream where we would expect them to be wanting to get their genes to the next generation, because the mortality is much higher in the adults, okay, than it was in the young. And he moved some of those guppies to establish a population in this third stream. So now everything's switched. And so now we have a situation where the guppies are going to be much better off if they're more careful about their breeding. Instead of wanting to invest more in breeding compared to their own survival, now it's the other way around. And evolution took place. And in only 10 generations in this third stream, egg production of the transigated guppies declined. So they invested less in reproduction because it was no longer safest to put their genes into the next generation. So what we're trying to show in these experiments and these comparisons of different kinds of fish and elephants is that ultimately it's natural selection that shapes life history patterns.